One of the most incredible sessions is called the Nashville Marathon, and over a five-day period at Studio B, they did 35 tracks.
Five nights,
just banged them out, and they were over three or four albums for the next few years, and just some really iconic songs of Elvis's that you guys were part of. But talk to me about the guy.
Well, Elvis Presley was the greatest singer I ever worked with, okay? And he was the greatest actor, too, because Elvis, there were two Elvises, okay? Well, you know the guy who comes out with a macho, you know, right? Well, that he developed that character. That was his character for singing and acting. But after I played with him from 1970 up until he dies in 77, over 120 tracks, and occasionally he and I would sit together and talk. One night in 73, we were at Sac Studios in Memphis. And, oh, Elvis was living a nocturnal life. He got up at 5 in the afternoon, had his breakfast at 6. He began his day at 8 o'clock, 12 hours away from the rest of us. Mm-hmm. And by 10, we'd start recording the records at 10 to 4 a.m. I mean, I'd be dying, okay? There's a track on Merry Christmas Baby. Mm-hmm. It's 4 a.m. on a Friday. Mm-hmm. I'm so faded, I can't keep my eyes open. And he keeps going. And we're 4 minutes, or 5 minutes. And I got my eyes open, and then somebody here, wake up, Pot! It's made me famous in Elvis world. I don't know. But no, the guy was so focused, he would clown around and tell the stories for 2 hours. And he was a great raconteur, okay? Great storyteller. And he had us laughing, and we'd forget that this is the biggest recording artist in the world. Over 1 billion records by Elvis Presley have been sold. And last year they sold many millions, okay? And he was just the sweetest, nicest guy. You know? He would sit and talk to me in his other voice. Hey, bud, how are you doing? What did your mother think about you getting into that business? And one night, we were at Stacks, we had our lunch at midnight. And we couldn't have anything more for catering, and I had some Italian food. Elvis always had a cheeseburger, order fries, and a Coke. Stayed true to himself. So I'm sitting on a drum riser well away. He sees me, comes over, and he climbs up the system. And we talk about our family. Now, the lunch is from 12 to 1, and had a great talk. At 1 o'clock, Elvis goes up and goes, hey, Pot, it's 1 o'clock. I'm going to have to beat Elvis. And he got up and he said, oh, fellas, we got 4 more songs to get. He went back into his Elvis voice.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you, though, he was the sweetest, nicest guy. I played on 120 tracks. He never asked me to change a note. Most of the producers, about halfway through the first run-through, come out and ask me to change all my notes. Okay? This guy was just a prince of a guy, and loved great playing and great players. And you answered your question.
And you did, and you got the opportunity over the last few years doing the Elvis Big Screen Show. You being a studio musician, you hardly ever, except for those early years, went on the road and played live concerts. You could do a great song like Margaritaville, and then you just went on to the next track. You had no idea of what the reaction was going to be. But what was that like to be on stage finally playing with Elvis and hearing the audience and seeing the audience?
Well, it was startling. You know, the great Jewish Chef played live with me in Vegas. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, after Elvis came in 1970, and we were able to accomplish 35 tracks, I went to work from about 10 to 4. So that's about a track every hour. He asked us if we'd consider coming to Vegas. Well, we thought that could be fun. And he said, well, Colonel Tom will call one of you and say, what do you call it, showing the coin? Now, you have to understand, I don't know what they put in the water. You have to understand that a good studio guy in 1970 would make $100,000 a year, $2,000 a week. And so Charlie said, well, if you pay us the $2,000 we make in Nashville, we'll come out. Tom Diskin called Charlie back and said, Colonel's willing to go as high as $350 a week. And so we never played for Elvis.
Yeah.
So years go by, and 6 years ago, now the Big Screen Show, Elvis has died, the Big Screen Show is playing all over the world. And it's the original rhythm section, but Jerry Schell is having some hearing problems. And I got a call from Paul Lyon and James Burton. And they said, Norbert, the books are out now with your name in there. You know, Ernst Jorgens put out a book, and they found out I was the guy making the records. And they said, would you come and play, because they already know who you are. You know? And I said, but I haven't played the bass in 30 years, seriously. You know? And James says, well, it's like riding a bicycle. Get in there and start with you. And I found myself about 6 weeks later on stage at the O2 in London, and with 12,000 people out there. We played all the capitals of Europe. We sold out everywhere we went. And there are these Elvis fans. And they're like the greatest fans in the world, you know. And I had to play a solo on something, or whatever it was. I played a solo, and they all stood up and applauded. That never happened in the studio, did you see? I gotta tell you, I was on a record session one day with all the old guys, and I did this burning killer guitar out of the bass part, and I go in the control room, and it's Grady Martin and all the boys. And they walked around and looked at the ceiling all the way through. That was the greatest compliment you could get from that. So yeah, so Presley was the greatest, and to be able to play for those people, those fans are the best.
Yeah. Well, we have a very special opportunity now, because to close out the afternoon, one more time, Putt, wake up, Putt.